Did you get a look at him?
Well, one was a youngster. The other one I couldn't tell for sure.
What do we do now?
Well, I'm sorry, but I guess you're gonna have to put on your boots and do what I'm doing. Walk.
I guess we better split up for the time being. I'll meet you in Boonesboro in a couple of days.
There should be some good pickings there.
Yeah. Yeah, you look around. Look around good. See if you can find some likely galoot for us to fleece. And don't forget, when I get there to give you a hand, you never saw me before in your life.
See you in Boonesboro, stranger.
Doing?
Oh, a good deed.
Sneaking up on a person like that? That's no good deed.
But I just saved your life. Did you ever hear the story of the ancient Greek who gazed into a pool and fell in love with his own beauty and turned into a statue?
I don't like people making fun of me.
Well, I wasn't. You're too pretty to turn into stone anyway.
And if I had a stone, I'd give you a clout you'd not soon forget.
I'd probably deserve it. I didn't mean to frighten you.
Oh, well, I wasn't scared. Takes more than a back-east stranger to spook me.
I'm sure it would. I'm from Boston. You know where that is?
Of course I know. We're not savages out here. I can read and write, and my pa's taught me plenty about the history of our country.
I'd like to meet him. My name is David Ellis. Do you live nearby?
In Boonesboro.
Oh, Daniel Boone settlement. Do you know him?
Well, might say we're on speaking terms.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And which way to Boonesboro?
Oh, it's straight up the road you're heading. Not more than 3 miles.
We made it, Marnie. We made it. Bless the Lord.
That's the way my pa always gives thanks to the Lord, in a loud, clear voice. Amen to that, Paul. Amen to that.
She's a young girl, isn't she, Marnie?
That she is, Paul. And she's got a handsome young fellow with her.
We come a long way, child. All the way from Philadelphia. I'm going to build me a house and open a business in Boonesboro.
A business?
I sell clocks. And I fix clocks.
But,
Well, blindness don't stop Paul. He can fix a clock like nothing you ever seen.
My hands, child, hands and fingers, they know the way. They have knowledge of their own. Yes, sir, I saved my money, and I'm going to open a shop here.
First one we're going to talk to is Mr. Boone.
Oh, he's not here. Well, I mean, he's not in Boonesboro.
Not here?
No, my father had to go to Salem on business. But he'll be back real soon.
Your father?
Yes, I'm Jemima Boone.
Halfway across this continent, and whom do we meet right off but a child of Daniel Boone? It's a sign, Marnie, a good sign.
You brought that all the way from Philadelphia?
That's right, son. I'm a master craftsman, and I kept it ticking all the way down the trail.
But weren't you bothered by Indians?
When they saw my paw was blind, they were real kind.
I guess there's compensations for being like I am.
What's compensation?
It's something you get for something that's taken away.
Well, they're teaching the children real good in school nowadays.
I'm not a child. And the correct phrase for teaching is well, not good.
Thank you, Jemima, thank you.
Do it again, Mr. Tolson. Do it again.
Excuse me a minute, I'll be right back. What do you want?
Oh, I wanted to talk to Mr. Boone about work. I heard the voices and assumed he had guessed. And I looked and I was correct. My apologies, friend, all right? My apologies.
Daniel ain't here.
You call him by his first name. You must be friends.
Yeah, we're friends. He's in Salem.
Ah, just as well I didn't knock and disturb everybody. When will he return?
About a week.
I'll have to see him then. We accept my apologies, friend?
I accept your apologies.
Good night.
Paul was the finest clockmaker in the colonies. With big clocks, I think he still is. It's a remarkable skill. All we need is a piece of land and a cabin.
Marnie here? Well, she's got a green thumb in the garden, like I got a green thumb with clocks.
Could I see it?
See what, dear?
His green thumb.
Oh, that's just an expression, Israel.
One time I got my hand all full of red from picking berries. Is that the same thing?
No, it's not the same thing. The red hand is a fact and the green thumb is a metaphor.
She's sure jumping tonight.
Mother, may I please go outside and get some fresh air?
I'll go with you. We'll go down by the creek and look for frogs.
You stay right where you are.
Jemima!
Mother, please, I just want to go outside and be alone for a while.
Very well. Please excuse her manners. She's acting very peculiar tonight.
Don't you know it's improper to scare a man like that?
Well, I just saw you here, so I thought I'd get even.
Well, I'm glad you did. I was hoping you'd come out.
You certainly were staring at the window like a Halloween goblin. It's a good thing nobody else saw you.
Oh, someone else did, that Jericho fella.
Oh, so that's why you went out.
Oh, we were quite friendly. We even shook hands. I asked him about your father.
What for?
To inquire about work. Well, the settlement looks fascinating to me. It's beautiful.
This place? Oh, it's just rough cabins and plain people.
Beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
You know, I don't altogether understand you. You're always talking in circles.
That's the way I move in my life, in circles.
Well, can't you ever talk straight about what you mean?
I mean, you're one of the most comely and charming girls I've ever seen. See what happens when I tell what I mean?
I'm a serious girl, Mr. Ellis. I don't go for trifling talk.
But I meant what I said.
Out here, words like yours don't slip off the tongue quite so easily. Real feelings, well, they take time.
I suppose they do. What do you feel about me?
Well, I don't know you. And I haven't kept company with a boy before, so I don't know much about that either.
Well, I can't suffer too much by comparison, then.
You're better to look at than most I've seen.
Thanks. I have a feeling that won't be enough.
You must have a very low opinion of yourself.
I don't have any opinion at all. I can't afford one.
My father says, what a man thinks of himself is what he can become.
He's very observant.
Oh, he has to be. To stay alive in this wilderness.
This isn't the wilderness. The wilderness is back there in the cities.
Again, you're just saying words.
Bear with him. I'll only be here for a short time.
We do need more men here. You'd be welcome.
I usually overstay my welcome, Miss Boone.
Well, if you do stay, it's Jemima.
Jemima?
My nemesis. I better say goodnight.
What were you doing with him?
Talking.
Do you know him?
Of course I know him. We've met.
Now listen, Jemima, I don't trust him.
I don't recall asking whether you did or not.
Your pa asked me to look after things while he was away, and that's exactly what I'm gonna do.
Would you mind releasing me?
It was you he came looking for, wasn't it? And he said he came looking for a job.
You know something, Mr. Jericho Jones?
What?
I'm not a child. So you take care of your business, and I'll take care of mine.
Well, this is it, Sonny. This is the place a man can make for himself a new life. Especially a young man. A fellow like you. You got muscles, ain't you?
Yeah, I got muscles.
And gumption?
Especially gumption.
Well, that's all's needed, then. You do a day's work and pull your own load, be a man or woman, young or old, you can make for yourself a brand new life.
Hear, hear. Have you got a job for me, Mr. Cincinnatus?
Well, I'd like to say yes, but I can't. I got a young fella working for me now. I reckon I ain't got no work here at all for you.
Good morning, Cincinnatus.
Morning, Becky. Mima.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You need something, Becky?
Indeed I do. A nice, strong man.
What for?
I found a cabin for the Tolsons. The old McNaughton place. You know, it's been empty for months, and I'm sure no one will mind if they move in. At least until we can have a cabin raising for them.
Well, the McNaughtons won't mind because they ain't coming back. When the Tolsons moving in?
Oh, this morning. I do have Jericho, but I'll need another man to help. You know, there's a wagon to unload and a cabin to clean and wood to chop.
Well, you get on back and get ready, and I'll see that somebody gets over to help you directly.
Thank you, Cincinnatus. Jemima.
Yes, ma'am?
We'll be going now. Good morning, Cincinnatus.
Good morning.
Where's this McNaughton cabin?
Ought to warn you that this job is for love of labor and for helping friends. No pay is being handed out.
That's all right. I'll be working for just about the amount I'm worth. Well, here it is, the McNaughton cabin. Welcome home, friend. I'll start unloading.
I understand you ladies need some help.
You still around?
Marnie, that's the young fellow we met on the trail yesterday.
That's right, Paul. The young man who was with Jemima.
You do need help, don't you? Mrs. Boone, you recall me. I was in the tavern when you came in. My name's David Ellis.
I'm sure we'd be most grateful for your help. Jericho, what would you like Mr. Ellis to do?
Chop wood. A home should have kindling and firewood. Stacks of it. Be a good day's job. Got the whole forest out there, boy. Go to it.
Well, if it's firewood you want, it's firewood you get. Nice to have met you, Mrs. Boone. Miss Boone?
It is curious.
What is, Ma?
Everyone seems to know that young man but me. Oh, well, let's get to work. Bring the brooms, Jemima.
Hello.
Hello.
I saw you come by with the wheelbarrow.
Did I impress you?
Well, I just came by to tell you that food will be ready soon. Oh, look at your hands. They're all raw and blistered.
Axe handles and I aren't exactly old friends.
Well, I'll go get something for them.
No, stay. Would you like to sit down? May I join you?
They're cooking deer stew.
That should be delicious.
Oh, it will be. It's my mother's own special recipe. I'm a fair cook myself, thanks to her.
Fair in many ways, thanks to her.
You've got nice broad shoulders and good bones.
Look, Jemima, why don't we just stop talking about me?
But I can't.
Try.
I don't want to.
But you only make me out to be somebody I'm not.
Well, you're not a violent man, are you?
No, I'm not. But violence isn't the only sin.
You have others?
Plenty of others.
Can't be very bad.
Why not?
Because I like you. And I couldn't like anything that was really bad.
Listen to me. You shouldn't be troubling with someone like me.
But I am troubled. Don't you understand? I am troubled.
So am I, blasted. So am I.
Thank you.
Mima? It's time for you to set the table, dear.
Yes, I was just coming. Well, aren't you going to come?
I'll be along in a minute. Go ahead.
Well, I'd better be getting back to my work.
Oh, David, don't run away. I was hoping we could have a little chat.
All right.
Where's your home, David?
It was Boston.
Oh? Do your people still live there?
Well, my father was a banker until the bank failed. Then my mother died several months later. I left Boston shortly after that. Is that what you wanted to know, Mrs. Boone?
I'm sorry, David. You have had a hard time, haven't you?
Forgive me, Mrs. Boone, but I'd rather not discuss it.
You know, David, it makes no difference whether it's Boston or the wilderness. Young people can be hurt anywhere. You won't forget that, will you?
I won't forget it, Mrs. Boone. Now I better be getting back to my work.
We'll be eating shortly. Why don't you wash up and come inside?
Afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Name's Kravick. Mike Kravick. I've been working my way cross country headed to Boonesboro. I don't mean to disturb you.
You're not disturbing me. I'm Mrs. Daniel Boone.
Dan Boone's Mrs. Well, now, this is a pleasure.
Oh, and this is David Ellis.
Well, I'm pleased to meet you too, son. Ma'am, I'm wondering, seeing as I'm feeling kind of tired and hot and dusty, you could spare a man a drink of pure water?
Well, of course. David, will you show Mr. Kravitz the well? And the road to Boonesboro is right down that road.
Well, thank you, ma'am. Thank you kindly. Well, partner, how's the pickings here?
There's nothing, Mike.
Nothing? Oh, come on, boy. This is old Mike you're talking to. I can just hear the coins are jingling in this air.
Mike?
Yeah?
We're going on. Out of here.
Oh, you're trying to hurry me out, huh? I'll tell you, boy, we'll move out just as soon as we get ourselves a big, fat poke. Because there's got to be money here. Now, I'm going to find that well. I got myself a powerful thirst.
They're going to be pretty curtains. They're sure going to be pretty.
Well, a new home should be more than just four walls. It should have pretty curtains.
Why, Mima, you talk as though you're planning a home of your own.
You're still working at that door. You sure take all the easy jobs, don't you?
Any job you take would be hard, even blowing feathers.
Who's there?
It's me, Mr. Tolson, David Ellis.
It's the garden, isn't it?
That's right.
I'm just standing here listening.
To what, Mr. Tolson?
To life. To the life that's coming. You can hear it, boy, in the wind, in the sound of the birds, and the sound of the bees. And it's good, this life that's coming. It's good. This place, it's right on the road into Boonesboro, right?
Smack on it, sir.
I'm going to make me a sign. A big sign, painted like a work of art. Tolson's Clockworks. That's what'll be on the sign. It'll announce my shop and my business.
How old are you, Mr. Tolson?
Well, lad, I won't see 70 anymore. But I'm like a clock. You take care of it, and it goes ticking on. Tick-tock, tick-tock, Tolson, Tolson. You see, we're the same. How old are you, son?
Well, I shan't see 20 again.
But you got a long way to 25.
Long way.
How would you like to learn the clock trade? Become a master mechanic in the mysteries of gears and springs?
You offer me a trade, sir?
Aye. And a respectable one.
But why, sir? You don't know me.
Because I like the sound of you. There's kindness, there's education and wit. You can be my apprentice, David. I'll teach you all I know.
There's more kindness in you, Mr. Tolson.
And you are looking for a new life, aren't you, boy?
What?
Everyone is always surprised at how much the blind can see. Well, you think about it. All right? You'll think about it.
I'll think about it, sir.
What do you see?
Everybody's dancing, Paul. Everybody's having a good time. Especially the young folks.
A christening. That's what a housewarming is like, Marnie. A christening. Like welcoming a newborn child into the world.
I see that boy David and that pretty Jemima.
Mr. Kravick, what are you doing standing there? Come on in and join the housewarming.
Well, thank you, Mrs. Boone.
There's punch for the gentlemen, punch for the ladies, and help yourself to the food.
I'll get around to it, ma'am. But first, I'd like to know who's my host.
The Tolsons. They're sitting right over there.
Oh, thank you. I'll just pay my respects.
Enjoy yourself.
Marnie?
I'm Mike Kravick, Mr. Tolson. I'm just sitting down to congratulate my host and wish him the best.
Thank you, Mr. Kravick.
This is certainly a sight and a joy to behold. Everybody having pleasure here in the wilderness. It's a sure sign of times to come.
That's just the way I feel, friend. A sign of the good times to come.
I'm just sorry Dan Boone ain't here. I rode all this way to shake his hand.
Folks owe a lot to him.
Yes, sir, that they do. I understand you're a clockmaker, Mr. Tolson.
That I am. And I'm opening a shop right here in Boonesboro. That's my faith in this country.
Well, that's all well and good. And meanwhile, a man's got to live. Just what do you plan to do until you get some business?
I'll be all right, Mr. Kravick. I'll be all right.
Will you now?
I got money. Saved all my cash for a rainy day. I can take care of myself for quite a time.
Well, now, I'm glad, Mr. Tolson. Yes, I'm sure glad. I just come over to offer my best.
Barney?
Yes, Paul?
We had a chat. Pleasant chat.
Well, thank you, Mr.
Kravick.
This is my daughter, Marnie, Mr. Kravick.
Well, the pleasure's all mine, ma'am.
Oh, that's for the grown-ups. This is for ladies and young ones.
Oh, well, I didn't want any, just the same. Thank you. I think I'll have a taste of that.
Oh, but it's not for young ones.
Do I look like a young one?
Oh, it's a bit sharp, but warming as it goes down. But it's not for you.
Come on, gather around now. We're going to have a square dance. Come on. Hurry up. That's it.
Have you been inside the cabin?
Here we go.
Oh, not since this morning.
Oh, come on. I want to show you something.
And now, one, two.
They've been together all evening.
Could be they're in love.
They just met yesterday.
I felt the same way 1 hour after I met Dan.
Could be something else, you know.
What's something else?
Could be taking advantage of her.
But they're marvelous.
It's like a fairy tale world, isn't it?
They sure fascinate me.
It's such a pretty cabin, isn't it?
Well, it looks like it can keep out cold and rain forever.
It's because it's a home, and it's meant for people who love each other. Oh, it's what I want, David. More than anything in the world, it's what I want. Oh, it smells so new. And it ought to be for people beginning new. Have you ever heard of first smoke?
What?
Oh, it's got a special meaning.
What's that?
Well, when a couple build their first home, and it's all ready for living in, they make their first fire and watch the smoke.
To see if the chimney works?
No. If the smoke goes straight up, well, it means they'll be healthy and happy and have lots of children. But if the smoke fills the cabin, well, they'll always be quarreling and never have any little ones. This smoke's going straight up.
Where'd you hear all this? From the Indians?
Yes, it's Indian talk. But it's true.
But this isn't a house for young people.
It's just about the right size. Small enough for me to take care of, and large enough if we ever have any...
Jemima.
Oh, I can see it all now. I'd wake up early in the morning and make him his breakfast. Send him on his way. In the evening, the place would be shining, and children's faces washed, all waiting for him to come home.
How quickly this all has happened.
Oh, don't you see it in the smoke, David?
Listen to me, Jemima.
Don't you want it all to come true?
It can't.
Why not?
Well, I'm wrong for you. Well, these clocks, at least they can tell the truth. I can't even do that.
Oh, that's nonsense.
Jemima. You don't know anything about me or about my past.
But it's not the past I'm interested in. It's the future.
Jemima.
Now, you listen to me. True, we've just only met, but I know how we feel about each other. Even if you haven't said it yet, I know. I'm sure.
But...
Did you hear me? I said I'm sure.
Jemima.
Now, ain't that pretty?
How dare you come sneaking up on us?
Your ma wants you.
Anybody with the slightest good manners at all wouldn't come...
I said your ma's looking for you.
You better go.
But...
Go on, I'll see you later.
At least you could have knocked on the door. Well, aren't you coming?
Later.
Now, listen here, Jericho Jones. If you've got any ideas, I mean, if anything's going to happen, you've got no right whatsoever.
Nothing's going to happen, Jemima. You go on outside. Do you want to talk to me?
Yeah, outside, in the woods.
All right. What's that for?
Just in case you don't answer my questions right.
What questions?
About Jemima.
Just what are my intentions toward her?
Yeah, you catch on real quick.
Well, I hope you do too, because my answer's none of your business.
Now listen, I'm not gonna let you lead her on, so you answer me, you hear?
I repeat, my feelings toward Jemima are absolutely private and of no concern of yours.
I'm sure your heart's in the right place, but you're stupid, do you know that?
Get up.
Look, I'm not gonna fight you over Jemima.
Because she don't mean very much to you, does she?
You're Jemima's friend.
Then I got your answer. You're a sneak sneaking around a young, innocent girl, leading her on. Get out of this settlement. By sunup tomorrow, I want you 50 miles from here.
He sure laid you out.
What do you want?
What's it all about?
Why don't you go ask him?
Now, you're kind of edgy, ain't you? He must hit pretty hard.
I asked you what you wanted.
Now, you, partner, I've been looking for you. I got something that's gonna make us both rich.
What?
Mm-hmm. You should have found out about it yourself. That old man Tolson's carrying a bag of money on him, gold. His life savings now. He is our Pickens boy.
He's not mine.
Meaning?
I'll give it to you plain. I've done a lot of raw things in my life, cheated, stolen, but I can't do it to that old man.
Oh, I see. You're getting principles, huh? All of a sudden.
Call it what you will.
Oh, boy. You really believe you could ever lead some different kind of life?
There won't be any kind of life for you if you try it.
That ain't nice. Now you're even starting to figure you'd be a match for old Mike, huh?
Anytime. You know something? I'm gonna stick with you all night just in case you get any ideas.
That's a good idea, boy. Yeah. You know, partner, you're growing into one fine man, huh? One fine man. Morning.
Well, good morning, Mr. Kravick.
Good morning, Mr. Kravick.
I see you're headed someplace.
Marnie's driving me into the settlement to pick up some supplies.
Oh, well, I'm going that direction, Mr. Tolson. I'd be glad to drive you there and back.
Why, thank you. That would be a kindness. Marnie's got an awful lot to do here.
I'd sure be grateful to you, Mr. Kravick. You can leave your horse here. I'll take good care of it.
Sure. That's a good idea. Thank you. Well, sooner started, sooner there.
We got a big list of things to get, Mr. Kravick. You sure you won't mind?
Mind? Why, no, Mr. Tolson. It'll be a pleasure.
A real pleasure.
And don't you worry, pretty lady. I'll take good care of
her. You're going mighty fast, Mr. Kravick.
I'm in a hurry, Mr. Tulsa. I'm always in a hurry.
That's because you're young. Old fellow like me, going slow has benefits.
If I find the right place up ahead, I'll let you rest a spell. Yes, sir. Quite a spell. Ha!
Have you seen Mike Kravick?
Well, sure. He was just here. He's driving Mr. Tolson into the settlement.
To the settlement?
It's a kind thing to do. People sure help people in these parts. He left his horse here. David? David, nothing's wrong.
What's wrong?
Nothing's going to be wrong, Mr. Tolson. It's me, David Ellis. Mike, I don't sleep so good.
Guess I should have made sure you did.
You should have. Put down those reins to get off that wagon.
I can't do it, boy. Not till I get what I'm after.
What is it? Will you tell me what it is, David?
He wants your money.
No. No.
Yes.
Thank you.
Find out who I am, what I am, not just for myself.
But you can find that all out here.
That'd be too easy. The people here are good, honest, and it wouldn't work. I have to go back to that other wilderness.
The cities?
The cities, where it all started, where the temptation is.
Why?
See if I can stand up to it.
Oh, no, David, please, no.
I've got to, Jemima. It's the only way I can give any kind of lasting meaning to my life.
That'll take time. A long time.
Maybe it will. But Jemima, if it works out, I want you to remember one thing. I know the way back.
You think he'll come back?
Perhaps. One thing's certain, though. When her father returns home, he's going to find a different Mima. She's no longer the little girl he knew. Dan's in for a surprise.
Daniel Boone was a man, yes, a big. And as tall as a mountain was he. Daniel Boone was a man, yes, a big man. He was brave, he was fearless, and as tough as a mighty oak tree. From the coonskin cap on the top of old Dan to the heel of his rawhide shoe, the riffinest, roarinest, fightinest man the frontier ever knew. Daniel Boone was a man, yes, a big man, with an eye like an eagle and as tall as a mountain was.